to get started. Like I said before, Taylor, I don't know which of your many achievements and accomplishments you would like highlighted, so I'm going to rudely let you introduce yourself. But take it away, do your talk, and then we'll take questions at the end.
Yep, sounds good. So, hi everyone. I'm Taylor Driggers. I just recently finished a PhD in fantasy literature at the University of Glasgow, kind of focusing on fantasy literature, queer theology, queer studies, religious studies, all of that kind of stuff, some of which I'm going to be sharing as part of this talk. I teach at the university. I'm currently supervising a handful of dissertations for the Fantasy and Lit course. So that's really, really exciting. I'm just really, really happy to be here. So I think we might get started. So I'm gonna just do screen share right now because I have slides. Right. Like I said, my name's Taylor Driggers. This talk is called Our Monsters Are Different. So I just want to give a little bit of a heads up that this talk is going to contain discussions of misogyny, ableism, homophobia, and transphobia. And also later in the talk, when I talk about Ursula Le Guin's Earthsea series, that's also going to involve some mentions of childhood sexual abuse, parental abuse, and human trafficking. So I just want people to be aware of that up front. And if people need to just kind of duck out of the conversation at any point, then that's absolutely fine. So with that, I think we'll go ahead and get started. The figure of the monster in the Western cultural imagination has often been a stand-in for bodies that do not follow the rules of respectable society. The medieval historian Geoffrey Jerome Cohen describes monsters as difference made flesh, and Jack Halberstam has argued that monsters are meaning machines. They have to be everything the human is not, and in producing the negative of the human, make way for the invention of human as white, male, middle class, and heterosexual. Monsters often reflect social anxieties about how stable the boundaries really are between a number of binary relations, sacred and profane, purity and defilement, decent and indecent, human and inhuman, and natural and artificial. They often exist in opposition to dominant understandings of stable identity, binary gender, and normative embodiment, and so carry the potential to disturb the status quo. But it's important to remember that they're also the means by which that status quo creates and repeatedly reaffirms itself in the first place. Discourses of monstrosity are used in social and political rhetoric, as well as in art, to conjure threats against which whiteness, hegemonic masculinity, heterosexuality, cisness, able-bodiedness, and the list goes on, must defend themselves, often violently, as dominant modes of being. In this talk, I'll be exploring monstrosity in pop culture and contemporary fantasy literature. While monsters can embody any kind of social and political difference or indecency, be it race, class, or disability, today I'll mainly be focusing on gender and sexuality. Monstrous depictions of sexualities and gender presentations that deviate from the norm have the potential to contribute to the demonization of gender and sexually marginalized people. But I'll also be asking how we can respond to portrayals. Can monstrosity be creatively reclaimed as part of a queer ethic? What would happen to the way we see ourselves if we learned to live with, even embrace, monstrosity? What might become possible? Of course, gendered and sexual monstrosity necessarily intersect with other axes of difference and oppression. And just as an aside, if anyone's interested in exploring more about monstrosity and race, Ebony Elizabeth Thomas has a recent book called The Dark Fantastic that has a very, very good chapter on race and monstrosity that I really recommend reading. So first, I'm going to highlight a couple of examples of monstrous women that people are probably familiar with. And both of these come from Disney movies. So let's start with Maleficent from Disney's Sleeping Beauty. As a villain, Maleficent is counterposed to the princess Aurora. Where Aurora is adored by all, Maleficent is socially outcast and crashes the baby Aurora's christening after having been uninvited. In the film, we aren't given much indication of why her magic is dark or evil compared to that of the other fairies, and most of what we have to go on are visual cues. Aurora and the good fairies are depicted with rounded or delicate features, whereas Maleficent is all sharp angles and dark clothing. In terms of her role in the narrative, she is the embodiment of indecent womanhood. Her role as antagonist stems from the fact that her curse on Aurora is meant to thwart the arranged marriage, preordained from Aurora's birth, that will signal an alliance between her father and King Hubert. In other words, if Aurora in the film is an object of beauty and purity, bred from birth to prop up the patriarchal authority of her father, Maleficent's drive to annihilate Aurora signals a threat to that same authority that by the film's logic must be destroyed. Also, she dresses like a drag queen and transforms into a dragon. We'll get back to both of those things later. The other monstrous woman that I want to talk about from Disney movies is Madame Mim from The Sword in the Stone. Madame Mim rejects respectable femininity to an arguably even greater degree than Maleficent does. She stays in the darkness of her hut in the woods, shuns sunlight, and revels in her hag-like appearance. Like Maleficent, she is a shapeshifter and a witch, but she can also shrink and grow in size. Even when she changes shape to embody a more conventionally attractive feminine figure, she does so in a mocking fashion. What's also strange about Mim is that she has a direct parallel in the film in the form of the wizard Merlin. Based on Disney's depiction of him, we're clearly meant to understand Merlin as a benevolent, enlightened, paternal figure to young Arthur. Judging by his contest of magic with Madame Mim, however, there is little to differentiate the actual powers displayed by the two. And as a result, we barely get any justification for why we're meant to see Mim as evil. Just gonna take a sip of water. So both Madame Mim and Maleficent are part of a long tradition of monstrosity being ascribed to bodies that don't stay put, that show up in places where they supposedly don't belong or inhabit those spaces in unexpected ways. And often this comes with very real consequences. Misogyny, homophobia, and transphobia can all be linked with cultural anxieties about bodies that desire what they are not supposed to desire, that come together, pun very much intended, in unexpected configurations, that refuse to maintain a stable shape over time, or be confined to a single identity category. Rosie Braidotti has linked the idea of shape-shifting feminine monsters to the way that many people's bodies change shape and literally become multiple during pregnancy and childbirth. But the way that Madame Mim and Maleficent change size and shape can also be connected to Sarah Ahmed's work on queer spatiality. To risk oversimplifying Ahmed's point, the idea that queer people perceive, inhabit, and move through space differently than heterosexual and cisgender people. The current British government, media, and medical obsession with policing and gatekeeping the lives of trans people is very much bound up in anxieties about this, about trying to manage norms surrounding identities that are supposedly fixed at birth, to advocate for a supposed natural order against the chaos of identities that may change over time, or desires to change the body. In Cohen's words, the monster is transgressive, too sexual, perversely erotic, a lawbreaker, and so the monster and all it embodies must be exiled and destroyed. So what do we do with all of this? I want to very gently suggest that it isn't enough to just say that these things are problematic and call it a day. While it might be true that these depictions are troubling, once we have answered the question, is this problematic, and if we're asking that question, the answer is almost always yes, we're left with the question of what to do next. It's become very popular in certain LGBTQ communities to increasingly advocate for humanizing or positive representations of queer life. And while I don't necessarily have a problem with doing that in art per se, I think we put ourselves in danger of repeating the violences of our oppressors if we deem any and all instances of monstrosity irredeemably bad. If we are living in a world where, at least on the surface of things, some queer people now receive greater mainstream recognition, security, and rights in public life than we once did, monsters ask what the cost of such safety is. Inclusion in a definition of human arrived at by violent means often means displacing that violence onto ever more vulnerable members of our community, who still fall outside the purview of respectability to a cis heteropatriarchal society. This is one of the reasons why I was slightly disappointed by the 2014 Maleficent film made by Disney, because for all that I find the newfound companionship and solidarity between Maleficent and Aurora compelling, and I find that very productive and generative in a lot of ways, I was also disappointed by the fact that the film still felt the need to rehabilitate Maleficent according to a Disney-approved sense of morality. It locates Maleficent's supposed villainy in an experience of trauma, but in the end, Maleficent is still the character who is expected to reform and become more respectably human. Monstrosity can be reclaimed as a way of challenging the terms on which the human and inhuman are constructed. As Cohen notes, the monster bears witness to the fact that it could have been constructed otherwise. Monsters bring us back to the challenge implicit in the reclamation of the word queer. If we are to be designated as different, what do we do with that difference? Inhabiting the position of the monster might allow us to tell its story differently, to reveal processes in its textual creation that might open on to other possibilities and alternate ways of knowing and being. Monsters, on a closer look, are prophetic truth tellers. Turning a critical eye to Maleficent's curse, for instance, might provoke reflection on how heterosexuality and traditional femininity are deployed to secure material wealth for men, or on how a life of subservience to men is experienced by many women as a kind of spiritual death, similar to the death Maleficent prophesies for Aurora. This point is hammered further home by the fact that the instrument of death that Maleficent ordains for Aurora is the spindle of a spinning wheel, in other words, an object of domestic labor. Monsters also offer us an opportunity to explore queerness not as straightforward representation, but as a crisis in representation. Especially in our current era of surveillance politics, machine learning, and facial recognition software, representation and hypervisibility quickly become synonymous with control. Monstrosity is a refusal to be contained and confined within such a gaze, that's gaze with a Z, before it can be analyzed. The monster always rises from the dissection table as its secrets are about to be revealed and vanishes into the night. This double movement by which the monster conceals at the same time as it reveals is strikingly similar to what happens in a drag performance. So I'll turn now to a drag performance from 2017 by Sasha Velour and discuss how it can lead us to understand the character of Gollum in J.R.R. Tolkien's The Lord of the Rings in a new way. So I'm gonna quickly queue up a video of this drag performance. And the sound might be a little bit fuzzy, but I'll also give description of what's happening in the video if the tech gods do not smile on us.
And we can share a link to the video on the Stay at Home Fringe Twitter later on. Zoom sometimes doesn't always do video quite right, but people who are familiar with Gollum from Lord of the Rings should be able to follow okay.
Yes, all right, great. Thank you, Lizzie. So I'll just cue that up right now.
Oh,
Okay, and the performance pretty much just kind of goes on like that. I'd highly encourage you to seek out the video and watch the entire performance and everything Sasha Velour does, because it is great. Let's see if I can start this from current slide. Okay, there we go. So this performance highlights how fantastic discourses like that of the monstrous can be invoked to heighten drag's subversive play on identity and embodiment. As Velour's Gollum first emerges on stage, the performer pantomimes over an audio recording of Andy Serkis's performance of the character in Peter Jackson's film adaptations. Immediately, a struggle is enacted between Gollum's fractured identities, the well-intentioned but timid Smeagol on one hand, and the abject creature of greed and malice manifesting the One Ring's power, working both over and through Gollum on the other. By inhabiting these plural but antagonistic personas, Velour's performance dramatizes not only the inherent disharmony of identity that all drag enacts, but also the heightened sense of disunity experienced by subjects confined to the closet and rendered illegible within the cis-heteropatriarchal order. In The Lord of the Rings, the One Ring is created by Sauron, a figure associated with monolithic, technocratic control and panoptical surveillance, and usually represented as a single eye atop a tower. While the ring is on the one hand a manifestation of an external evil, its power primarily manifests by working within the psyches of those who wield it. The ring also has the power to render its wearer invisible, but with the cost of making them hyper-visible to the eye of Sauron and placing them further within his control. Sauron's gaze is described as that growing sense of a hostile will that strove with great power to pierce all shadows of cloud and earth and flesh, to see you, to pin you under its deadly gaze, naked, immovable. This is experienced by many characters throughout the novel and films, but 500 years worth of internalization of the ring's influence permanently transforms Smeagol from a hobbit into a monstrous hybrid subject, with the greed for the ring reigning supreme over Gollum's consciousness. By displacing this struggle into her drag performance, Sasha Velour provokes comparisons between the violent fracturing of Gollum's subjectivity and the experiences of subjects grappling with the sway that homophobia and transphobia hold over their own presentation. In Velour's hands, the negotiations between invisibility and hypervisibility experienced by the ring bearers invites comparison to what Eve Kosofsky Sedgwick describes as the double-edged potential for injury in the scene of gay coming out. For Sedgwick, the closet is that curious space that is both internal and marginal to the culture, centrally representative of its motivating passions and contradictions, even while marginalized by its orthodoxies. Like the ring, it is a tool of hegemonic power, Sauron in the case of the ring, compulsory heterosexuality in the case of the closet, offering invisibility and shelter from immediate threat, at the cost of reasserting itself as the structuring force around which identity is organized and negotiated in social spaces. Moreover, the closet's unique status as an articulation of heteronormativity through silences and non-disclosures means that coming out cannot simply happen once. Rather, in Sedgwick's words, every encounter erects new closets whose fraught and characteristic laws of optics and physics exact from at least gay people new surveys, new calculations, new drafts and requisitions of secrecy or disclosure. Velour's embodiment of Gollum's split identity can be seen to enact the incoherences and discontinuities revealed in these negotiations of the closet. This subtext is made even more apparent by an awareness of the performer's identity as a genderqueer person whose drag is actually embodied by two alter egos, the feminine Velour and a masculine persona named Alexander Velvet. The voice clips Velour pantomimes occur at a pivotal point in Gollum's internal struggle in the films. As Velour emerges from behind the umbrella that just barely conceals her transformation, Gollum's malevolent side insists, "We survived because of me." Here, as recontextualized by Velour, the voice of internalized cis-heteronormativity speaks to urge the queer subject back into the closet for the purposes of survival and self-preservation. The performance segues into the Kate Bush lip sync after Smeagol, brought back to the fore by the compassion and care of Frodo, attempts to banish the influence of the ring from his consciousness, commanding it to leave now and never come back. Following this temporary moment of triumph, the monstrous body of Gollum becomes the site of articulation for the violent and disruptive desires of Emily Bronte's heroine Catherine Earnshaw from Wuthering Heights, as reimagined by Kate Bush. Subversive play on gender is an integral aspect of this act, but the monstrousness of its embodiment also deliberately takes on the grotesque discourses of representation produced by heteronormativity and binary gender, and flaunts them in a transgressive manner. Velour's performance shows how monstrous reference points can be used to add even further layers and complexities to the dance between identification and disidentification often on display within drag culture. So another example of monstrosity doing this, of portraying multiplicity in identity and naming sites of trauma and exclusion and oppression, comes in Ursula Le Guin's Earthsea novels. And just to reiterate the content warning from the beginning, this discussion is going to include some mentions of childhood sexual abuse and parental abuse and human trafficking. So if you need to duck out of the conversation for a little bit, then feel free. The shape-shifting dragons that appear in the final two novels of the Earthsea series, Tahanu and the Other Wind, provoke imaginative reflections on embodied subjectivity that suggests a potential to unbuild the walls set up by binary gender and liberate subjects from the violence it legitimizes. In doing so, they also disrupt previously established mythological and theological knowledge in the series. In the opening of Tahanu, Tanar tells a story in which the wizard Ogion encounters a fisherwoman who appears to him as a dragon for an instant. Then that was gone, and he saw no dragon, but an old woman standing there in the doorway, a bit stooped, a tall old fisherwoman with big hands. The dragon woman invites Ogion inside, and as they eat and talk, Ogion remarks, "When I first saw you, I saw your true being. This woman who sits across the hearth from me is no more than the dress she wears." The woman, however, shook her head and laughed, and all she would say was, "If only it were that simple." Ogion's encounter with the dragon woman disrupts the essentialist logic that has characterized the magical lore of the series up to this point. While the art magic practiced by the all-male wizards on Roke stems from the knowledge of true names, which promises direct access to the essences of natural phenomena as well as human subjects, the dragon woman disturbs the possibility of this notion. In both Tehanu and The Other Wind, the ambivalent embodiment of dragons destabilizes the notion of a fixed and unitary essence of gendered and bodily identity. Shapeshifters are no stranger to earlier texts set in Earthsea, since wizards can transform into animals for short periods of time. But transformation through the art magic operates in a deterministic fashion. Maintaining the transformation for too long makes the change permanent, so that the subjectivity of the wizard is utterly overtaken by that of the animal. Ogion's encounter with the fisherwoman places him in an altogether different, queerer territory, in which he is confronted with an irreducibly heterogeneous identity that eludes representation within the logic of his training as a wizard. As Tanar recounts, Ogion said the woman's embodiment was beyond all shape-changing he knew, because it was about being two things, two beings at once, and in the same form. And he said that this is beyond the power of wizards. More than simply refusing to retain a single shape over time, the body of the dragon woman displays such a discontinuity with itself that she cannot be coherently perceived as either truly woman or truly dragon. To identify either of these presentations as a mere disguise and the other as her true being only elicits laughter on her part. As with drag in the primary world, however, the dragon woman's story also points to modes of embodiment not present within the previous three novels. As she eats and talks with Ogion, she sings a song telling that in the beginning, dragon and human were all one, before they separated, the dragons choosing the freedom of the skies, and humans choosing to stockpile wealth and knowledge, losing their wings in the process. Her song also relates that there are those among us who know that they once were dragons, and among the dragons, there are some who know their kinship with us. It's no accident that the creation myth told by the woman of Kimei, which is not present in the lore of the wizards on Roke, is presented at the beginning of a novel that radically revises the Earthsea series' prior world-building and politics in other respects as well. Where the previous novel, The Farthest Shore, concluded with the restoration of balance to the world and the installation of a new king on the throne in Hafnor, Tehanu disturbs the supposed happy ending, with an emphasis on the violence and alienation experienced by gender-marginalized subjects, even after the king takes the throne. The novel's title character is introduced as a young girl who is sexually trafficked by her father and uncle, who then burn her in their campfire and leave her for dead until she is found and taken in by Tanar. This traumatic ordeal leaves her with severe facial scarring that renders her appearance monstrous to the other villagers in Realbi. When met with the sight of Tehanu's disfigured face, the superstitious villagers make the sign to avert evil, believing that the rich and strong have virtue. One to whom evil has been done must be bad, and may rightly be punished. Besides Tanar, only Auntie Moss, the village witch, is willing to take Tehanu under her wing. Tanar speculates that Moss's is a dark, wild, queer heart that is drawn to Tehanu not only by kindness, but by Tehanu's hurt, by the violence that had been done to her, by violence, by fire. Queer is used in the archaic sense, meaning strange here, but it accrues other connotations by The Other Wind, which gives more detail on the sexual lives of witches. Though seldom celibate, witches seldom kept company more than a night or two with any man, and it was a rare thing for a witch to marry a man. Far more often, two of them lived their lives together, and that was called witch marriage, or she troth. Witches in Earthsea embody sexual and social practices that are non-normative in their own society, and would be labeled as queer within our own. Although they do bear children, their sexual, familial, and child-rearing practices tend to be outside the heteronormative community organization of society at large. For this reason, witches are designated as monstrously queer people on the margins of society, even as the people of Earthsea venerate the male-dominated magical arts of Roke. This marking as queer often also coincides with literal birthmarks or other differences of appearance, as many women and men with such a blemish or difference about them become witches or sorcerers perforce. While Tahanu does not ultimately become a witch herself, her facial scarring draws Moss to her, and thus also provokes a reading of her as a queer subject. Le Guin's depiction of Moss also serves as a direct challenge to the villainous representations of monstrous women seen in figures like Madame Mim and Maleficent. "Come into the forest with me, dearie," said the old witches in the tales told to the children of Gaunt. "Come with me and I'll show you such a pretty sight." And then the witch shut the child in her oven and baked it brown and ate it, or dropped it into her well, where it hopped and croaked dismally forever, or put it to sleep for 100 years inside a great stone, till the king's son should come, the mage prince, to shatter the stone with a word, wake the maiden with a kiss, and slay the wicked witch. "Come with me, dearie." And she took the child into the fields and showed her a lark's nest in the green hay, or into the marshes to gather white hallows, wild mint, and blueberries. She did not have to shut the child in an oven, or change her into a monster, or seal her in stone. That had all been done already. Tahanu's marginality within regular society, her queerness, also coincides with a multiplicity of identity as both human and dragon. At the end of Tahanu, she summons Kalesin, the eldest of the dragons, to rescue Ged and Tanar from captivity, and the dragon addresses her as "my child." The Other Wind, meanwhile, concludes as Tahanu, now a young woman, transforms into a dragon and joins her sister Orm Irion and Kalesin in flight. Fire ran along her hands, her arms, into her hair, into her face and body, flamed up into great wings above her head, and lifted her into the air, a creature all fire, blazing, beautiful. Tahanu's existence as a dragon woman is consistently aligned with her monstrously perceived appearance throughout both novels. As Alder the Sorcerer reflects at one point in The Other Wind, her disfigurement made it seem that she had two faces. He could not see them both at one time, only one or the other. Tahanu's scars are frequently described as hardened and rigid, calling to mind dragon scales, and her voice, raspy and hoarse from fire damage, evokes the abrasive voices of dragons, described as a whisper of steel sliding on steel. There is a danger in reading these descriptions of viewing suffering and trauma as necessary prerequisites for queer fluidity and multiplicity, or just as worryingly, of pathologizing them as the result of such suffering. I would argue, however, that the conflation of Tahanu's scars with her hybrid identity as woman and dragon demonstrate both the threat of exposure that queer forms of embodiment pose to an inherently hierarchical and violent system of gender norms, as well as the further social marginalization many queer subjects experience within such a system because of that threat. As Judith Butler notes, if a person opposes norms of binary gender not just by having a critical point of view about them, but by incorporating norms critically, and that stylized opposition is legible, then it seems that violence emerges precisely as the demand to undo that legibility, to question its possibility, to render it unreal and impossible. Tahanu's facial scarring is associated with her disruptive embodiment and the multiplicity of her identity, not because suffering is an inherent condition of queerness, even if it is a present reality for many. Rather, it is a mark bearing witness to the gendered violence, and indeed to the violence inherent in gender, that society at large would prefer to cover over. In doing so, it points to the multiplicity of all identity and confronts the world of Earthsea with its silenced others. As the examples I've given in this talk show, reclaiming monstrosity is far from an easy or strictly utopian practice. It often involves marking and bearing witness to sites of erasure, exclusion, and oppression. And yet, in Le Guin's text, becoming the monster and walking the way of the dragon opens on to new possibilities for community with others. The most clear instance of the latter can be seen in the familial bonds shared by the dragons. Though born to different human families, Tahanu and Irian call each other sister, and both are called daughter by Kalesin. The non-essentialist reconfiguration of the family this creates is strikingly parallel to the found families that often emerge in queer communities, such as the drag houses that have emerged in Black and Latinx queer communities in New York since the 1960s. Butler has described these drag families as a cultural life of fantasy that not only organizes the material conditions of life, but which also produces sustaining bonds of community where recognition becomes possible, and which works as well to ward off violence, racism, homophobia, and transphobia. Tehanu's journey from an abusive biological family to found families, first with Tanar and Ged, and later with Irian and Kalesin, parallels the experiences of many queer people for whom a return to the biological family means the threat of violence and alienation. As Butler also makes clear, however, the fantasy of queer families carries the potential to be not only consolatory, but transformative. Coming to terms with and learning to embrace our own monstrosities may incite us to strive for communities in which identity is not preordained from birth, in which our desires and forms of presentation need not be fixed, stable, or naturally occurring to be legitimate, in which what we do with our bodies is not medically gatekept or organized into categories demarcating decency or indecency, in which we need not conform to dominant standards of beauty or fit into tidy categories of the human to be seen as worthy of dignity, grace, and love. The end. Thank you. And
Thank you.
And here's my bibliography if anyone's interested in doing any further
Fantastic.
Reading. I might just leave that up
there. If you want to leave that up for a little bit. I'd like to remind folks, if you want to ask any questions, please type them into the chat box that's provided. But seeing as there aren't any there yet, I'd like to raise a question of my own, if that's okay. I've been thinking a lot. I mean, I'm always thinking a lot about power fantasies, but especially right now that I'm killing so much time with video games. We get, you know, phrases like male power fantasy, where it's like, oh, I don't know, you get it a lot with superhero films, not to generalize a lot, but like the older superhero stuff. And I wondered, you know, this repeated theme you have of transformation, is that, would it be fair to call that a queer power fantasy, perhaps? Not to say that I, you know, when you mentioned Madame Mim, I remember that scene so well from Sword and Stone. And I, as a child, I was fascinated by how she could change herself so completely, and I've found her far more interesting than Merlin. So not to say it's exclusive to queer people, but that is, are we looking at a particular power fantasy that maybe appeals to a queer audience?
Definitely, and there's several things kind of within that, and you mentioned that not being exclusive to queer individuals, and I think that's definitely true. I think one of the things that is really generative to come out of a lot of queer politics and queer studies and queer activism is that what we're really trying to do is to reorganize power and reconfigure what power is and how that's understood. And that has the potential to liberate and transform not just the lives of queer people, but everybody, really, to break out of these reductive definitions of identity, these ideas that, who you are is preordained from birth somehow. So I think in a lot of ways it is a power fantasy, but it's a power fantasy that is specifically trying to think of how we inhabit power or how we empower ourselves in a way that is different from how patriarchy empowers itself or how heterosexual society empowers itself. We're basically saying, how can we inhabit more kind of non-hierarchical communities in that sense? Yeah.
I don't want to sound like I'm making light of it by calling it a power fantasy, because of course any power fantasy is coming from a place in yourself that you would like more ability, yeah, or more versatility maybe. Thank you. One thing to note, Tia Owen said, as a writer of queer fantasy, I absolutely loved that talk. I'm highlighting her because she is our writer in residence for the festival. Folks can check out her work. I've shared the link, the blog on our site. Thank you for being here, Tia. We've had a couple of questions come in. You will be discovering them as I do. I'll try to read them correctly. The first question says, do you know of any examples where what would traditionally be the monster is the normal, and the normal is considered the monster or other? Any thoughts on this? Just curious. I suppose that would be a situation, the first thing that comes to mind is maybe a sci-fi situation where we're the aliens, you know, humans, yeah, or something like that. Do any examples come to mind to you?
Weirdly enough, and it's kind of funny because it's not a very good movie, the first example I thought of was the 2007 film of Beowulf that Robert Zemeckis directed.
I was thinking of that actually
it's a terrible film, and it's written by Neil Gaiman and has a lot of the kind of Gaiman-y tropes, including kind of abject fear of women and sex and lots of things. But there is something interesting that I think that film is trying to do in saying that the monster that is perceived as an outside threat actually originates within the spaces that are attempting to eradicate the monster or defend themselves against the monster. So I think that movie is doing an interesting thing, and it's also kind of asking about cycles of violence and things, mm-hmm, like that. I just wish it were a better movie, because there's interesting things going on in it.
The common lament.
I wish I was better at thinking examples off the top of my head, because
take them later.
I could tweet them.
I know I'm over, yeah, here like looking at my books. I'm working on writing something like that, but this is not the time. Here's a question that is interesting. This person said, I have a question about the woman's subservience being portrayed as a way to achieve spiritual depth for women. Now, I heard you say death.
That was death.
So it's not depth, it's a sort of ending.
Right.
So that, yeah, I think that kind of clears up that question, because that was in the example with Aurora.
Yeah, exactly. And then the idea that if your reason for existing is to maintain these kind of patriarchal bonds of power, then that existence, a lot of people would probably experience as a kind of internal death. And what I was suggesting there is that Maleficent's curse of death on the day that she was meant to be betrothed to this prince kind of exposes that in some way, or has the potential to expose that.
Yeah. Another Disney villainess I thought of was Ursula from The, yes, Little Mermaid, who becomes a gigantic sea monster. And as a child, I watched that and I was like, I want to be a giant sea monster. I don't want to be a mermaid with legs who can't talk.
So, yeah. Also based on the drag queen divine, Ursula.
I see it in the eyebrows now. I didn't know that. Okay, so I'm trying to read questions. Someone just said that. I remember Steven Ursula was based on the drag queen divine. What do you think about Disney making a direct link between drag culture and the villain and the film?
Ooh. Yeah, that's one that I have some ambivalence about, because while I'm sympathetic to the criticism that is troubling, you know, that is in some ways, particularly in children's media, problematic. You know, as I've been saying, there's a potential to reclaim that. And particularly, I think when you're looking at such an institutionally conservative kind of mainstay like Disney, I think it's worth asking the question, do we want to be the hero by Disney's definition of heroism? I think that's a question worth asking. But like I said, it's thorny and complicated, and especially when Disney has a monopoly on children's media, it does become troubling when that is, the way of communicating or signaling villainy in a way. I can see both sides of it.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
This is an interesting point. The talk of disfigurement made me think of the way in which women and girls in Snow White and the Huntsman, another recent retelling, deliberately disfigure themselves to avoid being chosen by the queen to keep herself young. That is an interesting take on, because it's Charlize Theron who plays the queen in that, isn't it?
And it is, yeah.
Costuming in that is incredible. And she's given a lot of, she's given a lot more sort of visual and aesthetic power than the original version of that character. I haven't seen those films, but I don't think she's ever reformed. I think she just stays gorgeous and evil.
So, yeah, she stays gorgeous and evil. But then the point about that film, though, because I do really like that film. Mm. I think there's a lot of interesting stuff going on in it. That did just make me think about, you know, that's another way of using monstrosity to escape surveillance. In the way that I was talking about towards the beginning of the talk. That's a really interesting point, that, you know, in the world of the story of Snow White, hypervisibility is also, a kind of curse. It's the way that the evil queen exerts control. But that's also interesting, because you have the evil queen who's monstrous, and her monstrousness is kind of heightened by that movie. But then, yeah, you also have the deliberate disfigurement and facial scarring.
So there's some interesting things going on there.
Yeah. So that's kind of taking it in both directions and kind of having it both ways.
I'm definitely going to send you the chat log after this, Taylor, because there's just some really good comments coming in. Here's a question we should definitely look at. It's from an undergrad, we think. I'm currently writing my dissertation, which looks at the queer gothic and invasion into heteronormative society. Do you think that queer monstrosity can work as a queer power as much as a heteronormative attempt at othering? So I think, if I'm understanding that question right, it's using that monstrosity as a power, source of empowerment?
I think one of the things that can come from reclaiming and embracing monstrosity from a queer perspective is that in a lot of ways it disarms othering. If you are joyously inhabiting the form of the monster and saying, well, actually, I don't think there's anything wrong with being monstrous, and I'm going to revel in it, then that takes away not all, but some of the social power of othering. And in a way, it's similar to reclaiming slurs within queer communities. You know, it's saying, well, if I'm different, then what do I do with that difference? Then what else can be possible? I think it is very empowering, and I think it takes away a lot of the power from heteronormative kind of schemes of representation.
It makes me think again of Sasha Velour and the fact that in her drag, at least the one drag persona, you know, she does it without hair and with an added monobrow. And the rest of her makeup is, well, obviously, you know, by drag queen standards is pretty standard sort of gorgeousness, but then she's just got the bald head and it's a challenge to viewers.
Yeah.
No, I love her. I'm so glad you had that. I thought that the segue into Wuthering Heights was one of the best things I've seen in a while. Not only does it incorporate that secondary narrative of Wuthering Heights, but also that song is such an iconic, I don't know, it's sort of queer liberation going on there. Not only am I free, I'm going to do Wuthering Heights now. That was fabulous. So we'll definitely share the link to that video on Twitter.
Also, people from Glasgow might be especially interested in this, but if you haven't seen, I think it was about a week ago, there was a local drag queen named Darmageddon who did an online show last Friday night. And as part of that, she did a performance as Nemesis from the Resident Evil video games. It's incredible. Please watch it. Please follow Darmageddon and support her because
she's
an incredible local drag queen. So just wanted to throw that out there.
Fantastic. Okay, we have two more questions, and I know we have like 5 minutes, but we can run over. It's okay. So the first question here, I'm writing my dissertation right now on the portrayal of mental health, and I was wondering if you could maybe give your thoughts on how mental health is often portrayed as a form of monster. Now, that's something very close to my heart, too. What do you think of mental health and monstrosity?
I have to say I haven't sufficiently thought about it. I'm going to need to. But that is a very good question, and something that I'll need to definitely mull over and think on. I wish I had more thoughts on it. It's definitely an interesting thing to explore and important thing to explore. As well.
I'm looking at my books now for an example, but it happens. It absolutely happens. Person who asked that question, we're not naming names because it's getting recorded. And I think that there's a ways to go in sort of interrogating mental and physical health depictions in fiction. I think that there's excellent things going on with looking at queerness, but I'd love to see more going on with mental health, especially mental health when it, in people who are already marginalized, for example, you know, women who might be blamed for having hysteria for whatever reason, things like that. But really great that they're doing that dissertation. That's
yeah,
gonna be
amazing.
Awesome.
Yeah, amazing.
If we think of books, we'll post them. Can you talk a little bit more about the instance of redeeming queer villains, and how that translates into making them more acceptable to a cis heteronormative society, especially in terms of neoliberal culture that equates seeing imperfect queer characters as problematic, or that it does queer communities a disservice by not possessing a fully realized liberal identity. So is that sort of like letting the bad guy stay a bad guy?
Yeah, well, and letting people be complicated and flawed, I think, would be kind of putting that in a nutshell. And that's something that's very dear to my heart, and an issue that I tend to get quite ranty about on Twitter from time to time. I think it's of vital importance that we allow queer people to be messy, to be imperfect, to mess up, because we are kind of part of this minoritized community that is always told that we must be exceptional in order to be thought of as worthy. And that's something that a lot of minoritized communities
I've heard many people of color express that sentiment. Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah. And I think if anything, for people of color, that's magnified tenfold. But yeah, it's the idea of not being the exception. So, for instance, I do a lot of work in queer theology and queer religious studies, and something that you hear a lot, being a queer person in religious spaces, is something like, oh, but it's all right because it's you, or oh, but it's all right as long as you fit within these kind of parameters of decency or respectability. And that becomes very, very troubling when we start to see people in queer communities doing that to our own, and holding each other to impossible standards, while Marvel movies, for instance, get applauded for barely a shred of depiction of queerness.
I know.
So, yeah, I think monstrosity has an important role in disrupting that and in letting people be messy and be imperfect, especially because we live in a messy and imperfect world that indoctrinates us and that damages us and often leaves us as complicated people with complicated coping mechanisms for things. And I think that really needs to be given voice. And it saddens me that people see that as problematic or like something that needs to be eradicated.
Mm.
Yeah.
Can we spend the last minute here? Oops, we're at time, but still. Want to highlight that everyone follow you on Twitter. You're at Taylor Driggers.
It's at Taylor W. Driggers, D-R-I-G-G-E-R-S. I have a really weird surname. Right. Yeah. Sure. We found out recently that it's Polish. So there you go.
There you go. And would you like to leave us with any reading recommendations? I feel compelled as ever to mention the Broken Earth trilogy.
Absolutely. And K. Jemisin.
Everything.
Yeah.
Anything else? Obviously, Earthsea.
Yeah, read the Earthsea series. And anything by Ursula Le Guin, for that matter. The Left Hand of Darkness is also one of my favorites. It's a novel written in the 60s, but talking about non-binary gender in some really interesting ways, and kind of talking about what non-binary society might look like. Also, I really want to highlight reading an essay by Jeffrey Jerome Cohen called Monster Culture, Seven Theses. Anything that you're gonna read about monsters is gonna cite Cohen because he's kind of the person who, he's one of the people who first kind of started theorizing the monster as representing difference in kind of a very broad way. Also, he's a delight to follow on Twitter. He just a lot of dad posting. It's adorable.
I like that.
It's great. Yeah. But yeah, just read Ursula Le Guin, read N.K. Jemisin, read Ebony Elizabeth Thomas's The Dark Fantastic, because it's very, very good. It's an academic book, but it's accessible and it's talking about things like fan culture and Tumblr and fanfic, while also talking about race and monstrosity and all kinds of really, really interesting, really important cutting edge stuff that needs to be done in the field of fantasy literature. So that's
fabulous. Yeah. Okay, well, thank you. So that's all the time we have. This video is going to be uploaded to the internet in some form. It takes my computer a couple hours to process. I don't know why. So watch this space. But thank you everyone for listening in. And thank you so much, Taylor, for taking this time today.
Thank you so much for having me. This has been really, really fun.
This is awesome. Yeah, thank you. All right, I'm gonna close out. Everyone's posting very nice things. I will send you the chat so you can see.
Oh, thank you.
And yeah, all right. Have a good rest of your day, everyone.
Yeah, same to you.
Bye-bye.
Right, bye.